Welcome to the Jongets Games tutorial and playthrough for Batman the Animated Series, Shadow of the Bat. In this video, I'll be showing you how to play the game while we actually play it, and if you'd like to watch the rest of the game all the way to the end, then you can do so by clicking the link down below in the description, or by clicking the eye up there in the top corner. Now before we move on, I would like to ask that you please turn on the Klingon subtitles. That way, if I make any mistakes while we play, I can then put corrections on the screen and you should be able to see them. Now what's going on in this game is one player is in charge of all of the villain figures, and the rest of the players control four different heroes. So you're going to have a hero activate, and then the villain player goes, and then another hero, and then back to the villain. Now when the heroes activate, they use three action dice to do a variety of different things, but in addition to that, they get two extra actions from the dice of their neighboring heroes, so they actually share these action dice. Now the villain player does not roll dice for their actions, instead they have hand management, where they play cards that let them activate certain subsets of their figures. Now this is a scenario-based game, so the villains and heroes are trying to do a wide variety of things depending on the scenario, and I will describe how all of this stuff works in much greater detail as we are playing. Now before we jump into the game, I would like to ask that if you enjoy this video, that you please click the like button for it down below, as well as the subscribe button for the channel. Also, if you would like to directly support the channel in the creation of future videos like this one, then please go to jongetsgames.com/support. There you'll find a bunch of ways that you can really help things out, and some of them come with cool bonuses, like voting on a couple of the videos that I film each month. Alright, let's jump into the game. Out here, the game is fully set up and ready to play. Now I do want to mention that this is a prototype version of the game, so the art and components are not necessarily what you'll find in the final version. Now today, we will be controlling all four of these heroes right here, and our opponent is the villain Scarecrow. Now we have a scenario set up over here, and here is the introduction for it. With a blast, the Scarecrow and his henchmen storm into the Gotham University Bank, infecting the security guards with a fear toxin to ensure there is no resistance. The Scarecrow instructs his men to gather what money they can carry, then burn the rest. After all, this is a mission for revenge. As you can see, this is the bank, and Scarecrow is right over here. Now, out in the middle of the space, we can see these are the two security guard bystanders who have been infected with the fear toxin, and lastly, we can see the bank vault over here. Now it has two fire tokens in it already, and we are in a race against time to put out this fire. Fortunately for us, there is a fire extinguisher right down here, and in order for us to win the scenario, we have to put out all of the fire tokens in the bank, we also have to rescue all five of these bystanders inside the bank, and we have to knock out the Scarecrow villain. So we now know our objectives, but when it comes to our opponent, the villain, they are going to win if they knock out any one of our heroes even once, and they will also win if all six of the spots in the bank are consumed with fire. Alright, let's now briefly talk about the structure of the game. Now each round is split up into three overall phases, and in the first phase, each hero is going to roll their dice and simultaneously arrange them. Once that happens, we can move into the battle, and here we are going to select one of the four heroes to take their turn. After they take their turn, the villain can go, and then another hero can take their turn, which has not taken their turn yet in this round. Now after that, the villain goes again, so that means each one of the four heroes will activate once in the battle phase, and it means that the villain will take four turns, each one of these after a hero goes. Once all actions are completed, we can move to the cleanup phase, where end of round effects will trigger. Now at this point, the villain player will gain one focus up to their maximum, and for this specific scenario, if there is a smoke token out on the map adjacent to a fire token, then one of those smoke tokens will turn into fire. Now it also says we move the round tracker forward one space, but for this scenario we don't need to do that, effectively the fire in the bank vault is our round tracker. So let's look back to the bank vault, and as you can see there are four smoke tokens in it. Now that means if we don't do anything about this fire, then we will lose after four overall rounds, so we definitely need to make sure to take care of that, as well as trying to save these bystanders and of course knock out Scarecrow once. Alright, let's now start the round off with the heroes rolling their dice. Now before we do that, we need to look down to Batman over here, because he has a special pre-roll ability. We can see on the sheet that he is prepared. It says, before rolling your action dice, Batman may set one die to any non-bat side of his choice, then roll the remaining dice as normal. The die that has been set aside must become your center die for this round. Now every hero has custom dice, and we can see all of the faces printed on their board. Now that is the bat face, which they are not allowed to pick, so they can choose any of the other faces, and they have decided to go with this one right here. Now that's going to go in the middle, and I will describe the impact of dice positioning very soon. So they can roll their other two dice, and it looks like this is what they've got. And then at the same time, so will the rest of the heroes. Now that these dice have been rolled, each player has the option to spend one of their focus tokens in order to re-roll one or multiple of their dice. Now, in general, you can only ever re-roll once per die roll, unless you are Batgirl. As we can see down here, she is brilliant, and at the end of her turn, she will regain one focus. In addition, Batgirl may reroll a given roll more than once, spending one focus each time she does so. Now, when it comes to the timing for rerolls, each player can do this simultaneously, but once any player has actually taken a turn, no one can reroll their action dice again. Now, at this point, in addition to potentially rerolling dice, players also have the ability to arrange the dice in front of them. Now, this arrangement is important because each player is going to be sharing two out of their three dice with their adjacent heroes. Now, the ones that are shared are the ones on the left and the right side. So in this case, if Batgirl left their dice like this, then they would be sharing this one defend a die with Robin. Now, we would show that by pulling out this token and putting it right over here. So that is effectively another die face that Robin has. And then Batgirl would also be sharing this one ranged attack with Batman. So what this means is, every single time we take actions, each one of the heroes is effectively going to have five die faces to use, three of them from the dice that they have in front of them, and two of them from their adjacent heroes. So right now, that means that Robin would maybe arrange like this to give Batgirl one of these movement tokens, which would be important because up to that point, Batgirl did not have any movement actions, and at the moment, if Batman put this die over there, then he would be sharing this defend plus one melee attack with Batgirl. Now, when it comes to arranging, we have to remember that this die was set by Batman, so it must be in the middle. Now, it's also worth noting that if for any reason a player has to change their die face in the middle of the actions, and it's on the side that is sharing, then the shared icon will also change for that other hero. At this point, there is one more thing in the round that I'd like to highlight. Now, that has to do with Robin's Boy Wonder ability, and it says that at the start of the round, after rolling action dice, Robin may add one additional non-defend icon of the same type to one of their action dice that is not a die that's shared to them. Now, if this die is shared with another hero, then that hero also receives the bonus icon. Well, I've added these tokens down here to remind us of Robin's Boy Wonder ability, and at this point, let's now rearrange and reroll our dice. Well, it looks like Jim Gordon has decided they are going to spend one focus token, and they are going to reroll this melee attack. Their figure is right over there, and they are not confident they'll get to do any melee attacks this round, so they can reroll this, and they got a ranged attack plus defense die, so they like that better. Down here, Robin wants to spend one of their focus, and they are going to reroll one of their movement dice. Now, you could reroll multiple dice with that one focus spent, but they wanted to keep the other two. So in this case, it looks like they got a movement again, and remember, they are not allowed to reroll once again, so that is it for rerolls for them. Now, Batgirl and Batman can reroll, and it looks like Batgirl does want to do this. So they are going to reroll this defend die, and they got a bat symbol, so they can add that right over here. And then lastly, Batman is going to spend a focus to reroll this die, and it looks like they got the same result. Well, I think we are all done with our rerolls. Remember, Batgirl could continue to reroll more, but they are okay with the symbols they have. Now, once a player is done with their rerolls, but not necessarily finished rearranging, they can then activate each one of their bat symbols. Now, this effectively shows them marshaling their inner strength, and for each bat symbol that they get, they will gain one more focus up to their maximum. Now, the maximum is printed right here on the sheets, and each one of the players started the game with their maximum. So this is the main reason that so many of them rerolled dice, because they knew that they had these bat symbols to get that focus back. So in this case, we can see that Batgirl will gain a focus from this bat symbol, and then if that player is wounded, they can also roll one of these battle dice right here to try and heal wounds. Now, as you can see, these battle dice have a couple different symbols on them, but for every one of these hit symbols that you roll, you will regenerate one health. Now, obviously, every single one of the characters is at their max health, so they're not going to be rolling for healing. And then the final thing that the player has to do with the bat symbol is they have to set it to any other side on this die. So, obviously, bat symbols are a great thing to roll. Well, I think Batgirl is going to select the one movement side over here. Then Batman is going to get one focus back for this bat symbol. And then they have decided to select one movement as well. Now, over here, Robin is going to get one focus back for this right here. And then they're going to set the die to the double ranged action. And then finally, Jim Gordon is going to get a focus from this bat symbol. And they've decided to select the double range icons. So those will head right over here. And now we need to rearrange these dice. Well, I think Batman should probably put their dice like this over here. which means they will give this symbol on the right over to Batgirl, and then this move symbol on the left is going to be shared over here with Jim Gordon. Next up, I think Batgirl will actually leave her dice like that, so she is going to give one move over here to Batman and a single ranged attack to Robin. Next up, I don't think Robin is going to rearrange their dice, so they're going to be giving a move to Batgirl and a move over here to Jim Gordon. And remember, Robin can put one of these tokens down onto one of their dice that matches a symbol. So in this case, they are not going to add a move that would share over. They are instead going to add one over here to increase this ranged attack. Now, if they wanted to, they could move this over here and share that extra die with Jim Gordon. But Jim Gordon feels like they could probably use the extra move instead. So this will stay over here. And then finally, Jim Gordon is going to rearrange, and they have decided to put this over here like that, which is going to give Robin a double ranged attack, and it will give Batman this single range plus a defend. So at this point, we have now finished all of our rearranging, and it's now time to start the battle phase of the round. Well, the first thing that we need to do in the battle phase is collectively discuss and decide which one of the unactivated heroes will then take their entire turn. Now, I think let's start things off with Batman over here, which means they can now start taking actions until all of their dice as well as these shared action tokens are utilized. Now, they've decided to start things out by using this one move icon, and whenever you utilize one of your dice, you simply shift it up to show that you can't use it again this turn. So Batman can now do a single move action, and if we look down to their player sheet, it shows that a single action is going to give them 3 movement points. So let's look out to the board, and it appears that Batman is currently in the middle of the street. Now for every movement point, a figure can go to an orthogonally or diagonally adjacent spot, so that would be a single move right there. Now you may have noticed that some areas out here have different borders around them, and the yellow border means slow terrain. So players are allowed to move onto and over these areas, but it's going to cost you 1 extra movement point. So that means they can move onto here for 1 plus 1 or 2 movement, which would end their move. Now that is not what they want to do. Instead, they're going to use their final 2 movement points to go here and then over there. This means Batman is now done with this entire move action. But before we move on, I want to mention a couple other things. The first is that you can move up to your maximum move value, but you are not allowed to save any unused movements onto future actions. The next thing to point out is some of the other outlines here on the board. For instance, this right over here is rough terrain, and whenever you land on one of these spots, it does not have a move penalty, but you must end your move at that point, and if you want to keep going, you have to spend another move action. Now there is another type of terrain out here with this orange border, and that is unstable terrain. Now you can enter and leave this without any penalties, but you are not allowed to end your turn on unstable terrain. Now the next thing to mention with regards to movement have to do with enemy figures. Now you are not allowed to move onto a spot that has an enemy figure, but if this figure was right here for instance, you can move between them with a diagonal move. Now the other thing to mention has to do with having enemy figures in adjacent spots to the figure that wants to move. Now what happens in that instance is the figure that wants to move has to pay a breakaway penalty equal to a single movement point for each adjacent enemy around them. So that means if there is one adjacent enemy, then going from here to here would cost 2 movement, 1 for the move and 1 for the penalty. So it's going to be harder and harder to move with more enemies surrounding the figure that wants to move. Now there is one final thing to talk about with movement, and that has to do with terrain moves. As you can see, there are 4 of these listed on our game reference sheet, and whenever you do a terrain move, it is going to use your move icons. So this does not use the movement actions that you gain from your player board. You have to actually use the icons that show up here on the dice. As you can see, there are a variety of these here, and the only one I'm going to specifically mention right now is Leap. It is going to cost 3 move icons, which would normally give us 9 actions out on the map. But if we look right here, it says you can leap up to 3 spaces in a straight line, ignoring that breakaway penalty, slow and rough terrain, and line of sight. So leaping figures can pass through but not land onto other figures. So that is a nice way to break away from a bunch of enemies that might be surrounding a figure. All right, it's now time for Batman to take another action, and they are going to use this token right here. Now, as you can see, it has a ranged attack icon as well as a shield. Now, that shield is going to help out whenever figures are taking damage, and I'll explain how that works soon. So for now, they can simply shift this right over here, and they have a single melee attack that they can do. Now, if we look down to our player board, every one of the heroes has a base attack stat, which is listed under POW. So that means Batman has a base attack of 2 plus 1 from this single range attack icon. And that means they can do a single ranged attack with a power of 3 against an enemy minion. Now, whenever you do a ranged attack, you have to have a line of sight between you and the target that you are trying to hit. Now, in this case, I think we should target this Enforcer, and the way you calculate line of sight is quite easy. You just have to draw a line from the center of the square that you are in and the center of the target square, and as long as there is nothing blocking that line, we will have line of sight. Now, before we move on, we should probably talk about what can block line of sight, and the main thing is going to be black bordered terrain, which is specifically called blocking terrain. So that means we currently do not have line of sight over here to that crusher, because drawing a line right through there is going to intersect this black area here. Now, if there were enemy minions in between, that does not block line of sight unless the enemy minion is giant, which means it is larger than a 1x1 area, and we don't have any of those to deal with in this scenario. Now, there are other types of terrain that can obscure or block line of sight, but I will cover those if we run into them. Now, in this case, it looks like nothing is blocking this line of sight, so we can do a ranged attack against this Enforcer. Well, the way this works is we are going to roll a number of battle dice equal to the strength of this attack. Remember, you are going to add one strength for each of the attack icons, and we had one range, plus you also get the base attack of the character, which is 2 for Batman. So that means we can roll all 3 of these battle dice, and it looks like we got 3 hits. Next up, as the attacker, we have the option of spending a single focus to reroll as many of these battle dice as we want. Now, just like normal, you are not allowed to reroll more than once, and if we take a look at these battle dice, you'll notice that on 3 of the sides, there is a single damage, on one side, there is a double damage, which is great, and then on 2 sides, there is this block symbol. Now, when you are attacking, this effectively counts as a miss, so I don't think we should reroll, considering we are getting a hit on all of these dice, and we have a low chance of actually rolling a double hit. This means we are going to stick with this 3 damage, although we do not inflict that damage yet, because now the defender is going to do a defense roll. Now, the way this works is they are going to roll a number of battle dice equal to their shield value, and that is the number printed on here, as well as any other effects. Now, currently, the Enforcer just has the base 3, and again, 2 of these faces show a block. So every block that comes up is going to stop 1 damage coming in, so they can roll all 3 of these, and it looks like they did not get any blocks. Now, at this point, the villain player does have the option of spending a focus to do a reroll, and they do start with 4 focus, so they are going to spend this. So that means they are going to reroll all 3 of these, hoping to get some blocks, and in this case, wow, that was definitely worth it. They got 3 blocks. So that means we are now going to do 3 damage, but it's blocked by all 3 of these, so that means that no damage is going to be dealt. So that was certainly a great use of 1 focus for the reroll. Well, that was a complete miss with that ranged attack, unfortunately, and I guess that goes to show that just spending a single icon might not be good enough to actually overcome the defenses of our targets. Now, before we move on, there are 2 more things to talk about with regards to range. The first of these is that you are not allowed to do a ranged attack against any enemy figures that are adjacent to you. So that's why we were allowed to do this, because this figure is not quite adjacent. Now, the other thing to mention has to do with a range penalty. Now, for that, you are going to subtract 1 damage for each spot in excess of 2 that the target is away from the attacking figure. Now, we count that just like movement, so that means this Enforcer is 1-2 steps away, which means we would not have suffered a penalty. However, if we had targeted this Enforcer right here, which we do have line of sight on, then they are 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 spaces away, which means they would have had a penalty of 5-2, or 3 less damage coming in. So you only want to target someone very far away if you are very confident that you're going to do way more damage than they will block. Alright, let's now come back to Batman's area, and they still have all 3 of these to use. Now, before they activate any of these, I'd now like to talk about the skill cards that each one of the players has. Now, at the start of the game, we all were able to draw skill cards from a larger deck equal to the skill value that that character has. As you can see, Batman has a skill value of 4, and we have 3 skill cards here. Now, the reason this is 3 instead of 4 is because if a figure has the utility belt ability, then instead of taking 1 skill card, they can grab 4 gadgets. As you can see, gadgets are right down here, so Batman decided to have these instead of the skills, and these gadgets can be used once per game and then they are gone, whereas the skills can potentially be used multiple times. Now, if we look over here to these skills, some of them have costs involved. You'll notice for Shielding Cape, it's going to cost a single move icon, as well as one of your focus. Now, every turn, each hero can activate one of their skills, and it is worth noting that some of these skills have an infinity symbol in the top left, which means they are always active. Now, whenever a player uses one of these skills, they will be out there in front of them until their next turn, or until they are knocked out. Well, I don't think we are going to use any of these skills right now, so instead, let's use this icon right here to get movement, and that gives us 3 movement points. So let's look back out to the map, and if we wanted to, we could go 1, 2, 3 over to here, and for a free action, just pick up this fire extinguisher. Now that does seem pretty good, but that does mean that we would have Batman all by themselves with a bunch of enemies around that could potentially do quite a bit of damage to them. So I think let's maybe go a little bit slower, and we will just go onto this spot here. And with that, we are now done with our move. So let's come back to Batman's area, and both of their remaining dice have a melee attack icon on them. Now, they could spend one of these to complete an attack and then do another separate attack, but they have decided to spend both of these right now to add both of these icons into a single attack. Now, that means they are going to add 2 to these 2 here, which means their power is 4. And their only target right now is this Enforcer, because that is the only enemy that is currently adjacent to them. So we can roll 4 battle dice, and it looks like we got 6 hits. Now we are certainly not going to be re-rolling this, so let's leave this over here to the side, and then just like last time, the Enforcer is going to roll 3 dice to try and block. So in this case, it looks like they are just blocking 1 damage, and that means we are going to hit for 5. So we are going to deal 5 of these wound tokens out, and normally if the figure survived, we would just stack this up right next to that figure. However, if we look up here, we can see that the Enforcer only has 4 health. Now that means as soon as they take their 4th damage, they are going to be knocked out, so obviously this 5 damage is enough. So when they are knocked out, they will then be removed from the board. Well, at this point, Batman has now completed all of their actions, so that means their turn is over. Now whenever a hero completes their turn, the villain player can take a turn. And the way the villain's turn works is they are going to select a single card from their hand and play it out into this row. Now they'll put it face up like that, and if there was already a card in that slot, then they would slide the rest of these over to make room for it, and if there was a card in the 4th slot that got slid over, it then goes over here into the discard pile. After the card is played out, the villain player can now activate everything on the card. Now in this case, this one is called Crush, and it says during this villain turn only, when making a melee strike, the Crusher counts a double hit as if it was a triple hit. Now if we look down to the bottom of the card, it shows what activations they can do. So over here on the left, it says they can activate a single Crusher, and it can do these 3 icons worth of actions. Now in addition to that, they can activate any other figure out on the board, and then that figure can do 2 wild actions, which could be a move, a melee attack, or a ranged attack. Well, they are going to start off with their 1 Crusher, and it has a single move icon and 2 melee attacks. So let's look up here to the Crusher card, and it shows that for 1 move, they can go 3 times. Now we can also see that they have a special effect here, which says Huge Henchman, and it says that figures adjacent to each Crusher treat them as 2 figures when trying to break away. In addition, when a Crusher is defending, double hits count as blocks. So the Crusher can now move up to 3 times. And we're not too surprised to see this one go 1-2 to be right next to Batman. Next up, the Crusher has 2 melee attack icons, and they are going to use both of those in an attack. So that is 2 power right there, plus 2 more power from their board, which means this is an attack of power 4, and remember, for this turn, any of the double hits count as triple hits, so we are certainly hoping they don't roll any of those. So let's see how they do, and that appears to be 1, 2, 3, 4 damage, since the Crush card makes this a triple. Now at this point, the villain could spend a focus to reroll any of these, but they are pretty happy with this result, so now it's time for us to defend against the 5 damage that's coming in. Well, in order to do this, we have to look at our defense, and the base defense for Batman is 3, and then we add 1 more for every defense icon currently showing on these dice, whether or not we have actually used them yet. Now, that also counts for these bonus tokens, so that means we have our base 3 plus 3 more, which gives us 6 defense dice. Now, that certainly does seem like a lot, so now let's see how many blocks we get. Well, that looks to be just 2 overall. And at this point, if we want to, we can spend a single focus to reroll as many dice as we want. Well, we have 4 focus, so I figure this is probably a good time to spend it. So in this case, we can get rid of this right here, and let's reroll all four of these, and hopefully we'll hit some more blocks, and we hit one more. So I'm not sure if that was worth it overall, but this means we are going to block three of the five damage coming in. So that means we are going to end up taking two damage, which means we have to reduce our overall health by two. Now we can do that by flipping this 3 over to a 1, and you'll notice we started this game off with 13 health total, and if we ever hit 0 health, then that will knock us out, and if any one hero is knocked out, then that is one of the ways that the game ends and makes our Scarecrow opponent the winner. Alright, that melee attack is done, and it wasn't too bad for us, but before we move on, it's now time to talk about going on the defensive with a hero. Now, this is something that can happen whenever a hero takes at least one damage, and what it lets them do is rotate one of their dice over here to the single defense icon face. Now, that means they have one more defense going on for the rest of the round, but if we do that for one of the shared dice, then that will affect the shared token that is going to the other heroes. So that means if we rotated this over here to go on the defensive, then unfortunately Jim Gordon will lose out on that one move action, and they feel like having that move action is probably going to be good, so we are not going to go on the defensive. At this point, the villain has completed this one Crusher activation, and now they can activate any one of their other figures and do two of these wild actions with it. Now, it's important to note that the villain player is never allowed to activate the same figure twice within a round, so they cannot use this to activate the same Crusher that already went. This means the villain player has quite a few options, and it's worth noting that two of these bystanders right here are infected with the Fear Toxin. Now, whenever bystanders are infected with this, then the villain player can actually control them and attack us with those bystanders, but us as the heroes are never allowed to attack the bystanders back. Well, in this case, they want to activate Scarecrow right here, which is their leader figure. Now, they are going to start off with a move, and a single move icon gives them three movement. Now, they are going to jump right up here onto this rough terrain, and remember, whenever you go onto rough terrain, which is the counter of the bank, you have to immediately end your move. So even though they only moved once, that is going to complete one of their two wild actions, and with their other wild action, they are going to move again. That is going to give them three movement points, and they are going to go 1, 2, 3. Alright, the villain player is now done with their actions on this card, but before we move on, I do want to mention that if this card showed shield icons down here, then that specific type of unit would have extra shields for defense for as long as that card was out here on the row. Now, obviously, that is not the case right now with this card, but that's definitely worth keeping in mind. So, the villain player can now end their turn by drawing cards from the top of their deck until they hit their maximum hand size. Now, for this scenario, the max size is 5. However, Batman has actually changed that. Now, you may have noticed down here there is another effect called Escalation, and in a competitive game, the villain's battle hand size is increased by 1. So, that means their hand size is 6, and they currently have 5 cards, so they can't end their turn by drawing a card, and now it's time for one of the unactivated heroes to go. This means we can choose Batgirl, Robin, or Jim Gordon, but I think we are going to save that for the extended playthrough. Now, before we finish out the tutorial, there is one more important thing that I'd like to discuss, and that is called special actions. Now, these are actions that players can take on their hero turns, and it always costs one of your actions up here, so either a die or one of these tokens. Now, you can only take a special action when there are no enemies directly adjacent to the figure that is taking the special action. And realistically, there are three special actions that are going to come into play with this scenario. The first of them involves rescuing a bystander, and in order to do that, you simply have to be adjacent to the bystander, and then you rescue them, pulling them off the board. Now again, you can only do a special action if you have no enemies adjacent to you, so at the moment, these bystanders are pretty hard to get to. Now the next special action that we will need to do is inoculate. You may have noticed a couple of these bystanders are infected with the Fear Toxin, and you cannot rescue them while they are infected. Now, you can inoculate a bystander by rolling one of these battle dice, and if you hit at least one hit, so that is going to be on 4 out of the 6 sides, then you will successfully inoculate them and remove that token. Now, if you hit the block symbol right over there, then that is a miss, and you can take another special action to try and inoculate again. Now, the last special action that's likely to come up in this scenario is taking hostages. Now, this is something that the villain player can do, and again, they can only do this with one of their figures if it's not adjacent to a hero. Now, they have to be adjacent to a bystander, and they would simply take the bystander off of the board and then put this hostage token down next to that figure. This token is going to reduce their movement by 1, but it will increase their defense by 2, and if they want, for a free action, they can discard this hostage token to negate all damage coming into that player. Now, if they do that, then that hostage is effectively regarded as rescued, so that would kind of help us out. Now, there are many other special action options, like investigating, defusing bombs, as well as interrogating, but those aren't going to come up in this scenario. Now, at this point, I'd like to draw your attention over to the fire in the bank vault. Now, the way we can put this fire out is if one of our heroes has this fire extinguisher, and they essentially attack the fire with either melee or ranged icons, and they can combine them. Now, as long as that attack does 3 or more damage, then you will flip over that fire icon to the steam side, which is certainly going to help things out. Now, it is worth noting that if any figure walks onto a fire token, they will end up taking a damage. Well, at this point, I have covered the main rules to the game, which means the tutorial is now coming to a close. Now, there are many other smaller rules that are going to come into play, for instance, like the fact that Jim Gordon controls a couple of beat cops over here, and the fact that the Scarecrow can actually infect the heroes with fear toxin, and I will explain the details of all of those things as we run into them in the extended playthrough. So if you'd like to watch the rest of this game all the way to the end, then you can find a link for that down below in the description or by clicking the I up there in the top corner. And I hope you've enjoyed learning how to play Batman the Animated Series, Shadow of the Bat. As always, I'd like to thank everyone who's been supporting this channel, including all of these producer-level Patreon backers. If you too would like to directly support the channel and the creation of videos like this one, then please go to johngetsgames.com/support to see a variety of ways with which you could do that. Also, if you enjoyed this video, please click the like button down below as well as the subscribe button for the channel. Thanks for watching!